Let's pray together. Oh God, open us up. Open our eyes that we might see, our ears that we might hear, open our hearts that we might feel. And then, oh Lord, open our hands that we might serve. Amen. I have a secret to tell you, a secret to tell the choir. When I was in seminary many decades ago, I sang in the choir. Yes, it's a sad secret. They were called the Seminary Singers. All the cool kids sang in the Seminary Singers, so I couldn't really sing, but I wanted to be one of the cool kids, so I sang. They sang for chapel. They rehearsed on, I think, Tuesday, and they sang at chapel on Wednesday. And I can't read music, and I really couldn't sing, but I wanted to be one of the cool kids, so I sang in the choir. And it didn't take them long to realize that I really couldn't sing. But I sang very loudly and with much enthusiasm, sometimes along with everyone else, sometimes alone, sometimes on pitch, sometimes not. And it didn't take long, and they did this. They said, hey, Tom, I want you to stand there and put somebody with a really strong voice on one side of me and a really strong voice on the other side of me and a really strong voice right behind me. And some of you may be in that position. No hands raised. I was able to find the pitch. I was. I mean, it was remarkable that with all of those things in my ears and coming at me, I was able, most of the time, you know, to be able to find it. It's like the community carried me. That's what I want us to think about today. How the community changes us, carries us sometimes. Our series is, we're talking about how we shape values, our own values and those of those around us. We said first that we have to have clarity about what it is we believe, what those values are. We can't just be sort of namby-pamby and let our values be there. We have to be intentional about them. We have to have clarity. We have to differentiate ourselves from others around us sometimes and say, you know, others may think this, but as for me and my house, this is what we think. So that's first. Second, we talked about last week that it's more important what we do than what we say. So that, we want to set an example for others, and that's what's going to make the biggest difference in our circle of influence, whether that's our family, whether that's our colleagues, whether that's our friends, whoever is in our circle of influence, the actions we take will have the biggest impact, far more than anything we would ever say. Now, let me just say, this is something that I think sometimes we miss. It isn't so much... It is also the case that what we do changes what we think and what we value. It isn't just that changes what other people. Sometimes we get this mistaken notion that it is that we believe something, and because we believe it, we act on it. But the truth is, it's our actions that often dictate what we value. So there's a circle there, there's a cycle, right? So we want to focus ourselves on, there's a saying in the church business that says, culture eats mission for breakfast. What that means is that the culture of your church is far more important than anything you say is your mission statement. The culture is what you do, what the habits of your people are. And that is what is going to make the biggest transformation in who you are and what you believe. Now, I want to just reiterate something, and that is we put "and as for my house" in parentheses. This is all based on a series is based on a scripture from Joshua, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And we put it in parentheses, "and my house," because what's so important is to realize that "as and my house" is just an extension of "as for me." That the key is the "me" part, "as for me." And out of that will flow "and my house." So Andy Stanley wrote a book on making decisions, and we've been using it as part of one of the resources in our men's life this fall. And he says this, and I love this statement because it really cements what we've been trying to teach. "Self-leadership rather than authority is the key to sustained influence." Self-leadership rather than authority. Like, oh, I'm in charge of these, you know, I'll use kids as an example, right? You say, oh, these are my children, I'm in charge of them. Well, what you're really in charge of is yourself. And as you change who you are and how you behave and how you act, that's gonna make the impact on them. That's where your sustained influence will be, as you manage yourself. Okay, so that's where we've been so far. Today we want to talk about community. And I wanted to just lift up four things as we go forward. Here's the first one. Why are you here? Why are you participating in this live stream? You're here to be shaped, to be formed, to be more like Jesus. Because the communities of which we're a part are what are going to shape us to be followers of Jesus. Look, the passage that we chose today we could have chosen any of 100 passages in Paul's letters, because here was his strategy. Paul's strategy for spreading the gospel was not, let's go out and tell people to pass out tracts out on the street corners. Paul's strategy was, let's form communities, churches. And he's going to travel the world and he's going to plant churches. And these communities are going to be faithful communities. And those faithful communities will be powerful and magnetic. And people will say, wow, look what's going on in those churches. Look what they're like. Look at their love. I want to be like them. Because the realization was, if you want to make people disciples, they need to have a community that will shape them. This is something I mentioned a few weeks ago, but I want to reiterate it because it was really transformational for me. It was one of those things, you know. The four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts, call people who are followers of Jesus disciples. But in Paul's letters, the word disciple is not used ever. What do they call followers of Jesus? Sometimes they refer to them as saints, sometimes beloved, but the most common phrase is brother or sister. Because the picture was family, of community, of a group of people bonded together. And that was the essence of what it was to be a Christian. Was to be a part of these communities that changed you, that shaped you. We are shaped by the people around us. There is a psychologist named Robert Cialdini, and he wrote this in his book on influence. Whether the question is what to do with an empty popcorn box in a movie theater, how fast to drive on a certain stretch of highway, or how to eat chicken at a dinner party, the actions of those around us will be important in defining the answer. Social proof is a shortcut to decide how to act. If everybody in the movie theater is throwing their popcorn box on the floor when they're done, you probably will too. If everybody on the highway is driving 80 miles an hour in a 65 mile an hour zone, you probably will too. It's just the way we're made. We are social animals. And as much as we'd like to believe we are lone wolves that are not impacted by the people around us, that's not how we were made. That's not how we function. So what that means is we have to be intentional about the communities that we become a part of so that they will help to shape us in the way we want to be shaped. Do you remember the beginning of the pandemic when everyone decided to hoard toilet paper? There was no good reason to hoard toilet paper. There was no reason for it at all. But I got in my car and I drove to Kroger. And in fact, in our staff leadership team, people were telling one another where they could find toilet paper. You know, I hear there's some over at the Randalls over on Wesleyan if you want to go over there. Why? Well, you didn't want to miss out. I have a friend who went on a Carnival cruise, and he said that every once in a while, the rumor would go through the cruise line, through the ship, that they were giving away free caps over on the port side. And as soon as that happened, you could feel the ship sort of list to the left as everybody began to run over to the port side to get their free cap, because golly, you don't want to miss out. Friends, that's how we're made. And you know, of course, we don't want to be people pleasers, but we also have to recognize the human condition and use it to our advantage to say, how can we put ourselves into a community of people who will help to shape us to be more like Christ? Now, here's the second thing. It isn't just that we are here to be shaped. No, we are here to be shaped and to help shape others, right? Listen to the scripture that from Romans. We who are strong ought to put up with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us must please our neighbor for the good purpose of building up the neighbor. We are not here just for ourselves. We are here for others. We have been put here to be a part of that community that helps to shape others, to help hold them accountable. So it's a hard thing right now when so many of our folks, when many of you, because of safety concerns, are deciding to be a part of our virtual ministry. How can you be a part of a community? I can see how you would receive, but how do you choose to give when you're worshiping online? It's one of the reasons we want to encourage people to come back as soon as they feel safe, to be a part of the community of people around, right? But the truth is we have to be creative and think to ourselves, how can I, in whatever situation I'm in, do what I can to lift up others, to build up others, to help to shape them, to be a part of that community that's helping to shape others to be more like Christ? Some years ago, I was teaching one of our new member classes, and there was a woman there, a single woman, relatively young. And one of the questions I ask in the class is, why do you think God might have you here? What do you think God might want for you to receive? And what is it you might be brought here to St. Luke's to give? And so she said she'd been worshiping here for a while, and she always sat back in that corner over there somewhere. And she said she sat by herself, and the whole time she's thinking, what do I have to give? What can I do? How can I be doing this? What am I here for? One Sunday, a woman came and sat down next to her, an older woman, also single, sat in the same pew down a ways from her. And as the service began, she picked up her hymnal and they began the first hymn, and the woman who was in the pew with her was struggling to find what the number was and where she was supposed to go. And so this woman just had her hymnal open and she pointed to the number. It's not like they shared a hymnal or anything. She just pointed to the number. Here's the number. And the woman shook her head and found it, and they sang the hymn. And when it was over, the older woman said to this woman, "I like that hymn." And this young woman said, "I like it too." Well, when the service was over, they struck up a conversation. And she said, "Oh, I come, you know, on Sundays, and I always sit by myself." And the older woman said to her, "Are you going to be here next week? Can we sit together?" And the young woman hadn't really decided whether she was going to be there next week. But she said, "Of course, I'll be here." And from then on, they sat right next to each other. And she said, I realize that maybe why I'm here is simply to sit next to this woman and be her friend on Sunday morning. We all are here not just to receive something, but to give something, to do something. And it's hard during Corona land, right, to figure out how to do that. But you can send a link to somebody. You can invite them to watch with you on Facebook. You can send them the links to the Sunday morning worship. You can write them a note of encouragement. You can send them an email. You can make a phone call to somebody. You can decide in that time when we're not necessarily in worship together to invest yourself in trying to help to shape other people to be more like Christ, to shape them in love. All right, so we're here to be shaped and to help shape others to live and love like Jesus. That's the third thing. Listen to the scripture. Verse 3, "For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, 'The insults of those who insult you have fallen on me.' For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures we might have hope." So notice what he says in the beginning. He says, we should not please ourselves. And then in verse 3 says, because Christ did not please himself. Christ is our example. We are to live and love like Jesus. We are to model our lives, shape our lives after Jesus. That's what we're about. It isn't just that we're to shape one another. We are to shape one another in a particular way, so that all of us would, as a community, and then each of us individually, out of the power of that community, would be more like Jesus. Now, here's the problem. Sometimes that's not how we shape one another, is it? Sometimes the church shapes people to be more like Pharisees. Sometimes the church shapes people to be play actors. The word hypocrite literally means actors. Sometimes the church shapes people to pretend everything's swell and to smile on Sunday mornings. Sometimes the church shapes people to be like the Roman Empire itself. The Herodians were what they were called, people who supported King Herod, and the church becomes sort of a civil religion. Friends, those are the reasons so many people turn away from the church, right? Is because we aren't actually shaping one another to be like Jesus. But that's not always been my experience. That sometimes is true, but not always my experience. What I've discovered is that when we are humble, when we are willing to confess and be repentant and repent, when we are authentically desiring to be open to the work of the Holy Spirit, that God actually does work within the community. And we do find ourselves moving just, maybe just a little bit more to be like Jesus. It's an amazing, incredible thing what community can do and how it can change us. Okay, so we are to be shaped and to shape others, to live and love like Jesus, And finally this, together for the glory of God. To show the glory of God to the whole world. In other words, the point of the community of faith shaping us to be more and more like Jesus is so the rest of the world would see us and give glory to God our Father in heaven. Listen to the scripture again. May the God of steadfastness, this is verse 5, may the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. I love this term, harmony. Here's what harmony says. Harmony says everybody doesn't sing the same part. Harmony says that that everybody doesn't have to agree on everything. Harmony says there are some things that are not essentials. Harmony says that that what really matters is that we are united in the essentials, that Christ is our model, our Savior, our Lord, and that we seek to follow Him in every way we can. And that we reflect the love that God has for us in the way we love one another. That's the picture of harmony. Friends, I'll be honest with you. The world does not need more strident ideological culture war voices. The world does not need that. You can turn on your computer and they are all over the place. The world doesn't need the church to do that. What the world needs is a witness to the amazing love of God and what God can do to bring harmony in the midst of diverse voices, that people can come together to not make a point but to make a difference, to actually come together with the love of God and show that to people. I want to close with just this story from Fred Craddock. Fred Craddock was, in my view, the best preacher ever, maybe, and it's a story I probably have told before because it made such an impact on me. He grew up in a family where his father did not go to church, but his mother did. His father would say over and over again, all the preacher wants, all the church wants is one more number, one more pledge. One more number, one more pledge. That's all they care about. And he said that all of his life. But there was one time he did not say that. And it was in his last days. He had been struggling with cancer. They had removed his throat, basically, all of his vocal cords. He was being fed by a tube. And he couldn't speak at all. And in his hospital room, it was filled with flowers on the windowsills, flowers on his little food tray. Stacks of cards from people in the church who had sent them to this hospital room. Why? Because mom had gone to church. So let me just read to you the way Craddock says it. He saw me read a card. He could not speak, so he took a Kleenex box and wrote on the side of it a line from Shakespeare. If he had not written this line, I would not tell you this story. He wrote, in this harsh world, draw your breath in pain and to tell my story. I said, what is your story, Daddy? And he wrote, I was wrong. I was wrong. It isn't just one more number, one more pledge. It's about a community of people who love one another in a way that shapes us to look, to love, to live more like Jesus. I really hope that you will find, that you will invest yourself in a small group, a community, a Sunday school class, a choir, some community. If you're not a part of the church, that you would come, whether you join or not, to become a part of it, so that you might become a part of a community where you can be shaped and help to shape others to live in love like Jesus together for the glory of God in the world. Gracious God, what a gift the church is. Broken, imperfect, struggling sometimes, and yet you created us with your word. You breathed into the church the breath of life on that Pentecost day when the Holy Spirit filled us. And imperfect as we are, we believe you shape us with this community that we might look more like your son, Jesus. So God, use this church and every church that we together might give you glory. In the name of Christ, amen.